In this video, I will only explain using my slides how to install everything, and I hope that works for most of you. I will, however, provide two additional videos, one for Windows and one for Linux, where I do the entire installation process myself. If you're unfamiliar with that, then you can simply follow precisely what I do. And if you're lucky, it works. And if you're unlucky, we're going to meet on Thursday and I'm going to help you. Or you simply use the Jupyter Hub for now. Okay, so when installing it, you need to know about virtual environments. Virtual environments are sandboxes for your Python and its packages. And they allow you to have different Python versions with different packages side by side. If you use a Unix-based system, such as Linux and Mac, you're going to have Python installed anyway, because these systems have code which uses Python anyway. However, these libraries may need older versions of Python, as for example Python 2, and you don't want to use Python 2. I'm so glad that I can officially announce that Python 2 is now dead. This is the first iteration of this class where Python 2 is dead. Yay! We're going to use Python 3.7 because that's the newest version distributed by Anaconda. And this Python is maybe not the one that's needed by your system. And if you want to use the new Python and make sure that your system still runs, you don't want to replace your system Python by the new Python you install. And this is why you want to have two Pythons side by side. Also, you can have different Python versions, and you can also have different versions of packages. For example, Python 3.7, or rather in Python 3.6, for example, there were nice features added to Python. For example, the fact that dictionaries are now sorted. And I actually, or support for f-strings, which I love and use all the time. So I use these features of Python 3.6 all the time. However, there are many, many libraries which don't work with Python 3.6, for example, TensorFlow, or some web scraping libraries, or libraries for creating user interfaces. And now, if I want TensorFlow, for example, I want to have an old version of Python 2, or for example, also different versions of libraries. So you need, for some web scraping libraries, you need old libraries of other versions, and for some other libraries, you need newer versions of that, and they are incompatible. And if you only had one Python and every package you're installing on your system, then you wouldn't be able to, well, then you would need to reinstall that every single time, and that's shitty. So virtual environments are a solution for that. They're sandboxes for this very distribution of Python and its packages. So working with the default Python leads to a mess, or can even corrupt your operating system. And Conda, there are mostly three different ways of working with virtual environments, and that are vEnv, virtualenv, actually there's pipenv, so far, and Conda. And Conda is the easiest option to get Python virtualenv on all platforms. I provided here the links to different Conda cheat sheets where it shows Conda commands, but I'm going to use some of the commands in the videos I'm making additionally to this one too. So, what is Anaconda or Miniconda? So, Anaconda is a Python distribution made for scientific computing, packed with its own packet manager. So, if you have installed Python, you have the core programming language, which, well, contains the core features. Like, you can make loops, you can open files, you can print stuff. But if you want to have additional capabilities, like, for example, making user interfaces, or working with data, or plotting stuff, then you need additional libraries. They're not normally installed with Python, because these people that need Python don't necessarily need libraries for showing plots. So for example, like I said, on your Unix-based system, there's Python 2, but my Unix-based system never showed me a matplotlib plot. So obviously, there's no need for matplotlib. And different Python distributions provide maybe different versions of Python. So the standard version of Python is CPython, which means, so that's a compiler which is written in C. of Python, and they come packed with different package managers and different libraries. So Anaconda has many libraries packed within, more than 720. So that's pretty huge. It's more than 3 gigabytes. So you may not want to install full Anaconda, but that's the whole scientific computing stack, containing, for example, NumPy, Matplotlib, SciPy, everything Philip explained in the previous video, and many, many more, more than 720 packages. And also, so these environments need their own, so a Python distribution, Python needs its own package manager, because if you want to simply, if you want to easily install packages, you need some way of getting these from the internet to your computer, and that's basically what a package manager does. Pip, for example, is the normal, the standard Python package manager, pip standing for pip installs packages, and that can simply download packages from the Python package index, PyPI, and that installs it. And Conda comes with its own package manager, Conda, which for some packages is for sometimes it's the better solution than pip, especially when working with Conda virtual environments, and sometimes pip is the better choice. Just try both if you want to install a package you want to see. Okay, you can download Anaconda at this link, but I recommend to you Miniconda, because Miniconda is the same Anaconda but without all the pre-installed packages besides the Conda package manager. It's only 66 megabytes, and every package you need can be installed via Conda. So simply Conda install NumPy, and thus you get NumPy. So where it gets the packages from is obviously Python package index, PyPI. And if a package exists here, for example, NumPy, then you're going to see, there's NumPy, so I can pip install NumPy or Conda install NumPy when using the Conda package manager. Okay, I provide installation instructions for Linux and for Windows. So for Linux, you can simply download your version from this link, and that will then download the file miniconda 3 latest Linux blah blah, and then you can simply run that in your terminal using bash. So you open a terminal and then you run bash miniconda. So once you are at the respective place, you can run bash miniconda blah blah blah. I don't have it in this place, so I can't. And once you have installed it, which Python on your terminal, which Python should now give an answer like your home directory or whatever, slash anaconda 3 slash bin slash Python. And that's really good. If you don't have Git already, you can also install Git using the command sudo apt-get install. So I test if I have Git using rich Git, and I have some Git. So that's fine. I see here that already is my virtual environment. So Conda adds some stuff to my shell on Linux such that it knows, such that I always see in which environment I'm in, I mean the base environment. I can also Conda deactivate this environment. Don't worry if you don't understand this, I'm gonna explain this later. And now I'm not in my base environment, and for now one which Python, not in my base environment now, but in my system Python environment basically. And now it's, if I run Python, I'm going to use the system Python. I'm going to explain all of this later. And then to have JupyterLab globally on my system, I run these commands, and to create an environment for our class, I have to git clone the lectures repository, and then install everything in all the libraries in the YAML, and then activate that. So I'm going to make a separate video about the shell to teach you these commands, and I'm going to make a separate video about Git to teach you what Git does. Now, if you really, really want to, this is the fastest way to install everything you need. So this part here, these are two lines of code. This line here should download the newest version of Miniconda and install it directly and make your shell ready to run it. And this line here should then clone the lectures repository into your home directory, and then install already the environment and install the necessary stuff. So this is the easiest way on Linux. You can try to just run this, two lines of code, and everything works, and if you're lucky. Okay, for Windows, it's a bit different because you install it using a graphical installer and not the terminal. So you can download your version here as well, and then you run the graphical installer. So on the graphical installer, there are a few caveats. I definitely recommend you, strongly recommend, to add Conda to your path such that you can use it from a standard terminal. Conda, so on Windows you normally, so on Windows, on Linux you have the terminal, which I already saw on my machine. On Windows you have the command prompt, CMD. You open it by hitting Windows key plus R and then entering CMD. I'm going to show that in a video too. Or the PowerShell on newer versions of Windows. So if you don't add Conda to your path variable, which is simply something shown in the graphical installer, then you cannot run Conda from your standard CMD. And I think that's pretty bad, and I wouldn't do that. And especially if you also, so you always need to run the Conda shell if you want to run Conda commands. And I don't like having my own shell for that. Additionally, if you also install Git and you also don't add Git to your path, then you will also need to, so if you want to use Conda commands, you would have to use your Conda shell. And if you want to use Git commands, you would have to use, you have to open your Git shell, your Git bash. And I don't like that. So I would add both Conda and Git to this path. So I have, this here is the first. It will ask you if you want to add Conda and a Conda to your path environment variable. It says not recommended. I certainly recommend it. And I haven't found anybody in the previous iterations who had problems with that. Okay, then you need to open the command prompt as administrator, like I said, hit Win key, type CMD. Actually, then you want to right click that and select as admin. I'm going to show that in another video. Test if your installation was correctly installed, and then update it using Conda install Conda and Conda update Conda. And then you also install Git. It's also a graphical installer, and there are a few things we need to notice here. So first of all, you want to commit Unix style, because otherwise your code won't run on our testing machines, which means you won't pass your homework, and you don't want that. So, that's the third point here, commit Unix style. And also make sure that Git can be used from a command line. I even would also use optional Unix tools, but if you're not used to Unix-based systems, I wouldn't necessarily do that, but at least Git from the command line and also from third-party software. Otherwise, you would need your own shell, so your own terminal window, different terminal window for everything. And afterwards, you should have the commands Python, Conda, and Git as registered commands. And you can check that by running in your command prompt or PowerShell where Python, and if that returns something, some good path, it works. Where Conda, that returns a path, that's good, and where Git. And then the same commands as before, you open a terminal of your choice and run these commands, and also you want to create the environment for this class. If this is too much for you and you don't understand this, I'm going to provide an additional video. So make, for example, make sure that you're in the correct, like in a folder where you want to have it installed. So you cd your change directory to a folder. If you don't know how to change directory, look the other video. Okay, so for many of you, the previous installation process doesn't work that easy. And if you're sure you follow the previous steps as described and you still get an error containing something along of Qt linking failed, you can instead not install the complete environment all at once, but instead start with what's needed for the first few lectures. And that's basically where Jupyter, JupyterLab, and PyTest, and not install stuff like NumPy and Pandas yet, but install it on demand. We're going to explain for the homework exercise how to do that. So if you do this instead, you can then enable this environment just as if you installed it using the environments.yaml file. Okay, so after you have it installed, your shell should indicate that you have it installed. So I can run here, conda activate. I called it scientific program. I'm not sure how it's going to be called if you clone it. The environment here is called scientific programming, yeah. So this here is one. And then your bash should indicate that you are now in this environment. Oops, sorry. In this environment, which my shell here does indicate. Note that you need to activate this environment every time you work on the exercises. So because in this environment, using command pip list, I can show what libraries I have here. And for example, I have SciPy and Seaborn and all the needed libraries here. And to deactivate the environment, use command deactivate. And outside of this environment, I have less libraries. So I still have a bunch here, but that's because I, for many reasons, installed many other things on my system Python. Not on my system Python, but on my Conda-based Python. But you're going to see it's a different set of libraries. So activate your environment every time you work on the exercise. So instead of using pip list, which I just did, like I said, Conda and pip do pretty much the same thing. I can also use Conda list, which does the same thing. And it's actually more appropriate because we're using Conda here. Okay. And then you can start. So once you have installed JuPyter and JuPyterLab, which you should have done either by installing the entire environment using this command here, or by manually installing these. So see here, Conda didn't work. So that's why we installed them via pip here. Sometimes pip is easier, sometimes Conda is easier. And then you can run JuPyterLab by executing the command JuPyterLab lab dot. And the dot is basically the current folder I'm in. And that's what I would recommend to you. All right, now it automatically opened in my web browser. I just have it in another tab because this here is a private window. In my web browser, it opened. Let's open this. It opened the front end. So we see here on my terminal, this is the JuPyter kernel. It's running here and it needs to stay active. If I close this terminal window, the terminal is gonna stop and I can't continue working. And in my browser now, I see the front end. So this is the front end. Oh, where am I here? Where is this here? Never mind. And in my terminal, there's the back end. Okay, I'm gonna explain how JuPyterLab works in a second. But before that, I want to help you to get the lectures repository to run. Because it shows here in the lectures repository in the README, we already explain how to install that. It's not entirely complete, just these instructions here are more complete. And to see some pretty stuff in our repository, for example here the nice countdown, or being able to hide and reveal solutions, you need additional libraries, which are not only Python libraries. And to install these, you have to install everything as explained before. And then you have to open JuPyterLab, just like I just did. So this here is the one in the hub. The version I have here is that one. And then I have to build recommended. That's if I open JuPyterLab for the first time, that's what it's just going to pop up. And then I have to open a terminal again, and then I need to make this post build executable. That only works on Linux, but the other video. And then into one post build. And this is the script we have here. So post build should be, once you cloned the environment, and you're gonna have this in the correct directory. And then you can simply run this post build, and that simply then installs some JuPyterLab extensions. For example, the ones showing here that JuPyterLab solutions is, for example, the one to show these nice review solution things. I'm gonna show that in a second. Yes. And this is everything you need to get the lectures repository to be as pretty as it is with us. shortest installation instructions here again. And now I'm gonna show you JupyterLab. Full stop.